Rachel McDonald with the History Department at Abilene Christian University. Could you tell me your name?
My name is John Berg. I was headquarters and headquarters company of CCA, which is Combat Command Navy.
My name is Orrin Smith. I was with Combat Command A, Buff Armor Division, headquarters company.
Can you all tell me about your parents, where you grew up, and your childhood?
What was the last one?
Your childhood, just growing up.
I didn't get what you said there.
Your childhood, where you grew up.
Oh. I was born in Superior, Wisconsin. I raised in Superior, Wisconsin. Lived there until I went in the service in 1942 and served 3 years with the 12th Armored Division from the time it was organized in October of 1942 until I was wounded on April 11th, 1945. I was married when I went into the service and I was married in 1941 and I went in the service in 42 and had my son was born in November 15th of 1945. And what else?
Can you tell me about your parents when you grew up?
I was born in Barnston, Nebraska and attended schools there and also in Wymore, Nebraska. I graduated from high school in Wymore, Nebraska, and immediately had to sign the draft. And during that first summer, I worked as a signalman on the railroad, and then they wanted to freeze me on the job, so I quit and went to what they called a store factory, and they were making the wings for the troop fighters. And so that's what I did till February of 43 when I entered the Army.
Can you both tell me your memories about Pearl Harbor, where you heard it, and how it affected your family and those around you?
Well, I was in high school, and they had an assembly to announce that Pearl Harbor had happened, although we had heard it on the radio. But the superintendent called us down and told us how serious it was. It affected my family. I had two older brothers and they were in college, but they immediately had to go to the service. They left in December of 41. One went as the 2nd Armored Division and then to the Rangers in the South Pacific.
On December 7th, 1941, I was employed by a private party on the weekends as we called chauffeurs at that time. And I would take shopping or out to dinner in the evening or wherever they wished. Or on Sundays, I had to be there at 5 o'clock in the morning in case they decided they were going to go to early church. 9 times out of 10, they didn't go to church until 10 o'clock. So I sit there in the car. But I was sitting in the car waiting for them, and I had the radio on. And they come on the radio, and Pearl Harbor had been blasted. The Japs had made a sneak attack. And my brother, who was a year younger than I, was in the Navy at that time, and his ship was in Pearl Harbor. But fortunately enough, his ship had been out on a maneuver, and they were coming in off the maneuvers into Pearl Harbor when the attack came. And his ship commander, captain of the ship, was drunk, and they kept telling him that they were being attacked by Japanese Zeros. And he refused to let them fire until they fired them. One of the other officers gave the order to fire. And fortunately enough, nobody was hit on the ship or hurt. And very fortunate he never ever had to go into combat in Thailand. It was devastating on the whole family because both sides of the family, my wife's brother, he was taken in the Army right away and went to the Air Force, and he was immediately shipped to Africa before they ever completed their training. And he went to school, and then they shipped him to Africa, and they sent him then back to England to finish his training in Africa as a mechanic. And it was always a constant worry. So who was next?
To finish mine, I had one more brother, and he was in the Air Force as a crew chief on B-38s in India. And we all got home with Christmas of 45. And we were very fortunate.
I had many of my high school buddies had joined the National Guard. Some of them had enlisted in the services, so they wouldn't have to go in the draft. And I was killed in Bataan in the death march. And I happened to be in the hospital in 1945, and they were bringing back prisoners from Japan. And this one fella that they brought to the hospital where I was, Percy Jones General in Battle Creek, Michigan. My best buddy. Seen him bayoneted right through the face because he was so weak he couldn't stand. The Jap just took a bayonet and shoved it right through his face and killed him. You don't forget those things.
Can you
tell me about when y'all went first to basic training? What was that like?
Well, I went to Fort Crook, Omaha for induction, Nebraska. And then from there I went to Kansas City, Fort Leavenworth, where they assigned me to a 280th Signal Pigeon Company in Claiborne, Louisiana. I didn't know anything about pigeons, but the
didn't even know how to clean the coop by each
other. No, I never did either. But anyway, they had a bunch of fellows from New Jersey and New York, because in those days that was their little hobby, was homing pigeons, and so they were brought in the Army and put in these signal companies and for homing pigeons. And I spent from March to August there. And during that time, I went to mechanic school and ended up teaching at the mechanic school. And that didn't set well with the company commander. And we did take our basic training there. And then I applied for Army Specialized Training, which was a college program. And I went from there to LSU at Baton Rouge. And as we left the company, the company commander was an old CCC man, and there was four of us leaving, and he said, "You fellas better pass all those tests, because you never want to come back here." And so we passed all the tests. But we had a little problem in LSU. We all took our tests and passed them, but we were marching in formation to another test. And the sergeant was in charge, but it was also a co-ed. And one of the guys whistled at this gal, and so we all whistled at her. It was a little mistake, the commandant was walking by. And he told the sergeant to halt that platoon. He immediately told us that if we did pass the test, that he was going to send us someplace where we wouldn't have any trouble with girls anymore, or co-eds. So we ended up in New Mexico School of Mines in Socorro, New Mexico, which wasn't bad. It was a very good school. But we really didn't have too much to do. And girls weren't a problem. It was a very small town. And then we stayed there from August of 43 till March of 44 when they closed down the program. We were just short a month of completing our second quarter. If we had completed that quarter, we'd have done 2 years' work in that 9 months. And started at 7 in the morning classes, and you had 4 study hall, which ended at 10 o'clock. And if you weren't through studying, you went to the latrine and finished in there, because that's the only place there were any lights. And after the close of the program, there were 300 of us at the New Mexico School of Mines, and the 203 of us went to the 12th Army Division. And of that 203, we lost 9%. Take over.
Went into service, we went to Fort Sheridan, Illinois, and then from Fort Sheridan, they should start. And I was one of the largest drafts in the state of Wisconsin at that time. And they had 2 trainloads of us went into Fort Sheridan, Illinois. And we were all the way from Superior, Wisconsin, which is up in the farthest northern part of the state, all the way down to the southern part of the state. Men from Wisconsin, it was from every walk of life. And they unloaded us there in Fort Sheridan, and it looked like they were unloading the whole city. You know? And, of course, one of the first things they done was pick you down and give you a haircut. And they issued you your clothes, and you hope to God when they issued you the clothes, they fit. I was very fortunate, but some fellas, they put on their pants, they'd come up to their knees. Other guys, that, you know, they could have been in them twice and wouldn't notice them. And then after we got everything in, then I think we got 1 shot there. Of course, we got our hair cut, and we went to Fort Campbell. And there was nothing in Fort Campbell at that time. It was a brand new camp. No sidewalks, there was streets, but no sidewalks, no nothing. And all red clay. And then we pulled in there about 8 o'clock in the evening, and it was pouring, just pouring. And they had all our duffel bags and trucks. And they unloaded us out on the street, and we marched in and line up and then go to they assigned us to barracks. And you had to go out and find your duffel bag, which was out, laying out in the mud. And they backed up these trucks and they just heaved them. They could have laid them on the concrete, you know, but no, they heaved them right out in the ditch, and of course you waited out there. And it was about 11 o'clock, I guess, by the time we got into the barracks and signed the bunk, and we they took us over to the mess hall. You get something to eat, and got us up at 5 o'clock the next morning. And we was there for about 6 weeks before we started any basic training. All we did was clean windows in the barracks and scrub the floor and scrape the mud. And we finally got her going with basic training. And of course, none of us had ever seen a tank before. Lots of fellas had never ever been in even a dump truck, so they didn't know it, you know. So there was a lot of explaining to be done. And fortunately enough, I had spent 6 months in the CC camp one summer, just, well, not 6 months, about 4 months. I had a short-term deal, and I went in it when school got out, and I went back to school in the fall. So I had some, a little bit of military training, because in the CC camp, it was run by the Army. And we had a first sergeant. We had a captain that was our company commander. And we had a couple lieutenants. So I knew how to take orders, and I knew my left from my right. And I knew how to salute, so, and I knew how to make a bunk. That was a sad mistake when I told the sergeant, I made my bunk, and he says, who showed you how to make that bunk? And I said, well, I did. Yeah, I knew how to make the bunk. He said, well, as long as you can make that bunk so good, you can help me teach the rest of them. So I was spent several hours teaching the guys how to make bunk. And then I had to teach them how to make, do a right face and a left face and all this and that. And we, as far as the basic training, we would spend more time on the rifle range than we did with the tanks. And, you know, I think we went in the tank, shooting the tanks only a couple of days, and the rest of the time we were shooting rifles. Very, very little bit of tank training we had until late spring of 43. Then we really got into a lot of tech training with the tanks. And I went to school at Fort Knox for 3 months to radio operator school. Come back out of school and went on 12th went on maneuvers. I was at that time, originally went into 40, I was with the 44th Regimental Tank Battalion. And then they transferred me to the Combat Command A headquarters. And that's where I spent the rest of my time with the 12th Army. And when we was in Camp Barkley, we did a lot of training out in the field and maneuvers and stuff like that. And I think John got in a little bit of that.
Yeah, yeah. Got there in March.
Yeah, and so we went through a lot of different maneuvers and different, under different commanders. So then we went overseas. And we've never done any training over there that I know. I never seen any of it anyhow.
No, we went right in combat.
We went right from the States right into combat and got our supplies and took off. And,
what was the recreation like at Camp Kimball and Camp Barker? Because there wasn't any.
Very little.
Very little. We had, all the camps had theaters, and we had a few baseball fields. I never did play baseball, much as some of the guys did. And some of them had libraries. I know Camp Claiborne in Louisiana did. I went over there and boned up for the test. And that was about it. Most of the guys, usually outside of a camp, there's the bars moved in and things like that, because you're usually 20 miles from town or something. I know Claiborne was, and we were about 17 miles out of Barkley, weren't we?
Oh, yeah, a good 17, 18 miles.
And they call it Buffalo Gap, wasn't it? Barkley?
Yeah.
Where everybody went.
Yeah.
Good drunk. Yeah. Forget some of the week.
If you wanted to get into trouble, all you had to do was go down there and bar. You could get in all the trouble you wanted. Not only with the girls either.
But after I got to the 12th, there wasn't much time for recreation. We had we'd be out in the field 2 weeks, and then about 3 days, wasn't it? Then we were right back out.
I ran back out that one time.
And that's how I got married on one of those 3-day weekends.
So how was that?
Well, my wife was from home, and we'd gone 4 years together before that, and so she rode a train down from Wymore, Nebraska, through Kansas City, and on down to Louisiana, or up to Abilene, Texas. She had to stand through Kansas and almost to Wichita Falls, Texas, before there was a seat for her. And then one soldier just made room for it, and so she was able to sit down the rest of the way. And there wasn't any food on the train. You had to pack lunches and bring those. And she ran out, and so this one soldier went down to the military car that was a diner and brought her back sandwiches, I remember. And then she got into Abilene at 5 in the morning. And I asked for a pass to meet her, and I was refused. And so I went to AWL and met the train at 5 o'clock and got her over to the hotel. I don't remember, was it Grace? Was there another hotel there besides the Grace?
There's Windsor or the Hilton, because they built a hotel, but the Grace is the one that's right across from the Hilton.
From the old depot. Is that kind of on the northeast corner? Yeah. Well, that's, so I got her there, and I made a dash back to camp to get there for Reveille, and I had one guy that would yell for me. And so it's, I was just about to make the formation, it had already been made, and they called my name, and we both hollered. That was a little touchy there for a little bit, but nothing ever happened about that.
Well, I figured, see, you got short change going in the Barry.
Yeah.
You had to run over to the, our shower and everything was set in a separate building.
Yeah.
And you had to take a shower, you grabbed your towel and everything, and you went over there and took a shower, you wanted to go shave, you had to go over there to shave, you had to, you know, you can go, bathroom is all.
It's called, a latrine in those days, and everything was there.
Yeah, it was something else.
Do either of you recall General Brewer or anything about his relief from his position?
Who?
General Brewer.
No, I didn't know anything about him. But,
he was gone, he didn't, and of course, before we ever knew it, he was already transferred out. I did talk to a full colonel overseas, and he had just seen Brewer over there.
Oh, was he over there?
Yeah. And this colonel that I talked to, he had been with the 12th. And when we were down at the supply depot, that's what he was in. And he was disqualified for combat as a colonel because he had something physically wrong with him. And they were going to kick him out of the army, and he begged them not to kick him out. He wanted to serve. So they put him in with the kind of non-combatant service, and he got to be in this army supply depot down in England. And we got talking about it, and he was telling me that the general had failed as a leader for the division, and that's why he was transferred. But that's the only thing you ever hear, you know.
Yeah.
It's all second and third hand, and how true that is, you never know.
Describe to me the train trip to Camp Shanks.
Yeah. Pardon?
The train trip to Camp Shanks. Can you describe that for me?
The difference between the camps, you're saying?
No, just
the
trip.
Ride.
The trip.
Oh, well.
So let him go first.
From going from Tennessee maneuvers to Texas, I thought we'd never going to get there. It seemed like that train stopped every time some cow flagged it, waved his tail. You know. And it was cold. Cars were cold. Food was cold. For the short ride, it took us, I don't know, I can't remember how many days it was. It must have been on a train at least 4 days going from Tennessee to Texas. And the train ride as far as going from Texas to Camp Shanks, that was another long one. Anyway, we had better cars than one, and we did when we went from Tennessee to Texas. But it wasn't too bad.
We embarked on the train from that building at the end of the boulevard as you entered Barclay. I think it was called the Recreation Building, but the foundations are still there that supported the roof beams. And railroad track used to come up right on the, I guess it'd be the east side of it. Yeah. And we all got on there about between 3 and 5 in the afternoon. And like our little film said, all the fellows that weren't married got on first, and the ones that were married got on last, so we were able to sit with our wives. But then we got on there, and then we went up through Kansas and on up to Chicago. We sat in the Chicago yard about 5 hours.
Oh, man.
And then we left there in the evening, I remember, and the next thing, when we woke up that morning, we were going over to Niagara Falls. So we had swung up into Canada and back into New York. And this was in September. We left September 19th, and I think we got to Shanks about the 22nd, didn't we?
Yeah,
right in there. And Camp Shanks was, it was fall, and trees had started turning, and it was really quite a pretty place where we used to march those roads, wasn't it?
That was a nice camp.
And they gave us a couple of passes out of there, one really, to go into New York. And I went there with another fellow from the camp, and he was from New Hampshire, or from the 12th, I should say. And he had met some of the performers on Broadway in the past. That was Ray Churchill.
Oh, yeah.
So he wanted to go up this one apartment and just see a couple of the guys. And so when we got up there, we got in on a big party. So we didn't see much of New York. We saw Times Square and the ferry back to Shanks and that party. But we had a good time.
Can you describe to me the voyage across to Europe?
We left Camp Shanks on a train and went down to the dock, and we went to a big warehouse, as I recall.
Mm-hmm.
And you lined up in that barracks, that warehouse, and you had your barracks bag. And I can't remember, did we have our guns issued at that time?
No.
I didn't think so. Anyway, and then the gangplank went up the ship, and your last name was called, and you answered with your first, and you hit the gangplank, and you were assigned different areas on the ship. I was assigned to the mess hall and dining area, and I was supposed to sleep in a hammock over the dining tables. One night on the ship, swinging back and forth up there and hitting the other guy, was enough for me, so I just took that hammock and put it under a table every night. And we were on the Empress of Australia. We were told it was an old Kaiser yacht, which was not true. The Empress of Australia was built in 1922, and it took a trip like the Titanic started and went clear around the world. And it was, I think, finally decommissioned and scrapped and around 53 or 54. But it had been a luxury ship, but it wasn't very luxurious for us. And I spent most of my time on the fantail, or we sat outside on the promenade deck, and we had been issued little life preservers. They were just a little pad of keepot, one about 10 by 12, weren't they?
All I had was those belts.
Oh, I didn't, I had one of those English, English jobs.
Because you was assigned to the dining room, you bugger. We were down in the hole, so we got garbage.
And anyway, they had a little battery light on, so if you went over at night, you turn this light on.
Okay.
But we would sit on them, and we were constantly reminded, you can't sit on those, they won't save your life, they will be squished, you know, support us. And the general opinion was that it didn't make any difference because they weren't going to support us anyway. And nobody was going to see that little one-cell battery light out there in the dark anyway. But it took us 14 days to get there to Liverpool. And the sea was quite rough. You could sit on the fantail and you could look up at the waves and then you could just go look way down. Probably, I would say, about a story or two, wouldn't you? And then we had one event, destroyers or cans were, excuse me, supporting us, and I knocked it off. And they would fire rounds every morning, and they were up their guns. And finally, the sirens went off one day. You remember that?
Yeah.
And those destroyers turned around, headed for the rear, and they had a sub problem, submarine problem.
So they were shooting those cans?
Yeah, and then
right out alongside of us there, practically.
Then we heard the depth charges. And then we were supposed to go into Cherbourg, weren't we?
Yeah.
And they,
originally, yeah.
Yeah, and they detoured us into Liverpool because of the sub action. But they did take all our equipment on into Cherbourg, our tanks and trucks and everything. So we didn't have those in England. We didn't pick them up till we got to France.
I remember when John was talking about on the side of the ship we were on, they had done the sub chasers. And of course, we'd never seen this before in your life. It was, you know, just like going to a circus. Boy, this is fun, you know?
Yeah.
And they were shooting those depth charges over the side of their ship and then back in, you know, and they'd blow in that water, spray all over it. It was an exciting afternoon, I'll tell you.
It was almost close to our ship, too close.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about the Bell of Rosheim?
Well, we didn't have too much to do with the casualties. Being in a non-combatant unit, we weren't equipped, and we had no medics with us. We depended on the medics from the infantry and whatever. And the only thing we would do if they needed was we would put the wounded on the back of our tank and haul, and we did that a few times, but we never did it when we was at Herlishing. I was in the tank company, tank platoon that we were with, but it was supposed to be the commander's tank or the general's tank. We were always, very seldom the general ever went with us. It was always some other officer. We'd be up and liaison with the infantry and the other tank battalions and stuff like that. And we were up near the that water works.
Yeah, the water works.
Yeah.
Along the canal.
Yeah, around by the canal when they ordered this auto there. And it was chaos because there were tanks going in every direction. There was infantry going in every direction, and heavy fighting, and we finally found our way out and got on the right road and got out of there without any casualties to us, although there was several hundred 12th Army men that were killed and wounded and taken prisoner in it. Should have never happened. never had. Our intelligence really goofed up. And whether it was, I heard a couple times when before I was wounded, from different officers that I was with, that they, it was kind of on purpose, they were going to make heroes out of themselves by sending all our troops in there and whip the Germans that we could whip them without any problem. That the 12th Armored was the toughest outfit over in Europe at that time. They figured that we could handle it without any problem. So the sad part of it was that they had more heavy equipment. They had several large Tiger tanks in there, a lot of heavy artillery.
Well, they had really two divisions. One was a Panzer tank outfit. The other was 19th German Army, really.
Yeah.
But as far as the evacuating the injured 82nd Medical Battalion established the forward aid stations. And there you had doctors that did what they could to stabilize the wounded. And then there were ambulances back to the
back
hospitals, yeah. And from there they were evacuated again by ambulance companies to other hospitals for specialization. The forward aid stations had 50-gallon barrels. Did you see those?
Mm-hmm.
And they just throw the limbs and stuff in there as it came out. We were somewhere in Germany, I don't know if that's that before you got hit or after. But we were forced back to the forward aid station and we're in that area and they shelled us that night. And as we were establishing some protection for the forward aid station. And like Warren says, we were a headquarters company and yes, we could fight if we had to, but it wasn't really our purpose. But anyway, when they bombed us, the Germans bombed that forward aid station. And the first sergeant and I were digging foxholes and we just dug one together. And when the shell started coming in, it hit the forward aid station and I made it first and he came in on top of me and he was a pretty big guy.
Even though Tiny Tim would put it that way.
But it killed a number of the fellows in that forward aid station. And it didn't bother the Germans much to do that. The Red Cross was, especially by the SS, wasn't observed very often.
Well, it was on the 11th of April. I was supposed to go on a rest period. I suppose I shouldn't be there. And I was supposed to go on a rest period, and the crew was getting ready to go out, and I was going to go get cleaned up and go on a patch. Come to command, they kind of told me that I had to go with the tank. And I said, well, why? You know the other fellow, the driver and I were both to go together. And he says, no, he says, Maddie's going on past, you got to go with the tank. And Maddie says, no way. He says, Warren's got to go on the front. He said, I'm going up front too. We're going past together. So, company commander didn't like it well, but he says, well, that's the way you want it, that's the way it'll be. kind of, we'd been together long enough, so we knew each other. And I told him he goofed off. He goofed off. I'd tell him, you know, there was, he wouldn't get mad, and he could tell me, and I didn't get mad. But we worked together. So we went up, took this officer up to the, to meet with the infantry and the tank battalion commander, German Sergeant Schell in the town we were in, an all-timer. How do you pronounce that?
The little town?
Yeah.
I can't remember.
Anyhow, it's right near Schweinfurt.
Yeah.
And we got hit, the tank artillery hit us. They took from there, they took us out of there in the ambulance and took us to the aid station first, and then from the aid station to a back hospital where they did all the major surgery and took care of me and got ready. And our nurses were there and doctors. And our nurses don't get enough credit. They're the hero. Those girls saved many, many lives. And I was there for about 5 days. And those girls were 12-hour shifts. And many times we had a, if they'd bring in a wounded, they had to have care. But just like we'd say, it was intensive care here now, you know, in the hospital today. Those girls would stay up, take turns at night, take care of that man, and the next morning, get up and go on shift, put in a full day. And I see him shed a lot of tears. And then from there, I was flew to Reims, France. I was there just about a few days, and then I went to a hospital in England, which I was there until about the middle of June, between the 1st of June and the middle of June. And they shipped us back on a hospital ship. And I was scheduled 3 different times to fly back. And this morning, the nurse come in, "Well, Smitty, we're going to get ready today." She says, "Here's your papers, you're all set to go. You pack your bag." So that little stuff I had, you know, personal stuff, I packed my little bag and put my paper in it. And wish they'd hurry up and come and get me so I could get out of here. You know. Finally, she would, you'd have to really know her to appreciate her. She looked like she was about 90 years old, you know. She was probably about 35, 40, tough as a nail. She'd come flying in the door, and she said, "Well, damn it, you're not going today. Give me those papers." And take the papers. Okay. Didn't think nothing of it. 2 days later, same thing. So, about 3 days after that, same thing. So, one day she comes and she says, "You're going today. I'll guarantee you're going today." I said, "How am I going?" She says, "By plane." I said, "Nope." And she says, "Why?" I said, 3 times, no. You know, 4th time, bang, I'm down in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. Because when they were flying us from France to England, one of our planes just about went in this canal. Channel. When the engine went out, and when he come in, we watched, we were up here, and he was down here coming in. We was going to land in the same field, but he was there. And he was so close to that landing, getting that runaway at the beginning of it, that the nurses were just sitting there holding on, and their knuckles were just white. You know, and they had 22 men on board there. All on litters. If he would have went in the channel, we would have days on a boat. And that was a, tell you, what an experience that was. We were treated like we were king. You know, we were only, there were some officers on there, but they didn't get no better treatment than we did. And enlisted men, boy, I'll tell you, I just practically snap your fingers and those nurses would come running. What's the matter? You got trouble? You need something? You know? But anyhow, I was glad I waited and I wound up in the hospital at Percy Jones General in Battle Creek, Michigan, which was a amputation center. And, a real good hospital. And from fellows that I knew, there were in other hospitals in this around the country. It was one of the better ones. Had a lot more freedom. We had come after you'd been there, and you were on the road to recovery. You had a pass. It's good for 24 hours a day. As long as we was there in the morning to see the doctor, if he said okay, you could go till the next day. So we had, it was really good. I didn't mind being there at all. The time went fast. And, again, I can't say enough for the nurses, and especially in England, in the hospital, where we were getting, the wounded were coming right off the front line. And you wondered how they ever made it as far as they did. And there, this one fella had been a, they were bringing, starting to bring prisoners back, PW from Germany, and I was still there. And some of them had been wounded and not properly taken care of, you know. And the German medics didn't take care of them very good. And they, this one fella that was on my ward, took one look at him and I thought, man, they're going to put the sheet over him anytime, you know. And those nurses, they worked on him and worked on him and worked on him. And one morning, just got up. I was the only one out of 54 guys in our ward who was able to be up and around. So I had helped the nurses, like, bring the guys water. As fellas that couldn't feed themselves, I'd feed them give them bedpans and stuff like that, you know. And they helped. And I was up, and all of a sudden, there's the monk working around this fella. She let a beller on him, and the other nurses all come running. They brought a gurney in, and they took him rushing down to the surgery. And of course, they come back. They didn't work in surgery. And I said, what happened? And he'd been wounded in the chest and in the shoulder. And he got hit in the stomach. I guess he had an aneurysm in his stomach, and they operated on him, but they couldn't save him. And those nurses out there, it was something out there. It was like losing your own brother, you know. But they never squat, never. And like I said, if it hadn't been for those nurses. Now, another thing in the hospital was one day, after I was up for a couple of days, I kept walking by this one door. And the door was only open about that far. Sometimes there'd be a light on in there, and sometimes it wouldn't. And so, well, curious me, why, you know, what's going on? Is there somebody in that room, or is it, you know, a room where nurses go in and relax or something? So I said one day, I said to this little nurse I had, what's in that room? She said, there's a patient in there. Well, I said, how come his door is always closed? I said, nobody, you can't see him. Nobody in there. What's going on? And she got kind of red in the face, and she said, it's not my idea. Not mine. I said, well, Lieutenant, I didn't say, you know, I'm not accusing you of anything, but why? He's black. And I said, you mean to tell me he's shut off from the rest of it? Why not? She says, we can't put him out here. Well, I said, I'm going in there. And she says, well, you better not go in there without the doctor's permission. I said, I don't care what the doctor says. I'm going in there. I says, and I went in there, and the poor guy, his eyes just about popped out of his head. What are you doing in here? I come in to see you. He was in a body cast with me. Right. And I said, what's your problem? They don't ask him what was wrong with him. He told me his back was broken and he got shot in the hips. He was a platoon leader. And I says, do you request that door to be closed? And he said, no, I wish it was open so I could see somebody once in a while. I said, well, it's open now. So I says, is there anything I can do with you? And he said, yeah, would you write the letter for me? I said, sure. So I wrote him a letter. Sent it to his aunt and uncle who had raised him in New York City, and they had a restaurant there. So every day I spent some time in the morning, sometime in the evening with him, and sometime in the evening. Nice guy, real nice. And he come back on the ship with me. And we got to be pretty good buddies. And then we got into Fort Dix, New Jersey, where the hospital there, off the ship. And he called his aunt and uncle. Here they come, there was 40 guys in our room, the ward. They come with homemade pie and ice cream for all of us. Yeah, how do you like that, you know? And then for a long time, I kept track of them. We wrote back and forth. And all of a sudden, never heard from them no more. So I don't know what ever happened. But we got, you know, that really hurt me. And, you know, I was in Battle Creek in the hospital. And they're the same way. Those guys were isolated off in other rooms. They, you know, they never mixed them.
Right.
The guys with their legs off, their arms off, same as the rest of us. They would never mix with me.
I wanted to complete that about the what happened to the killed in action at the aid stations. They were taken from there, especially the Battle of Hiroshima, and the I think of the tank with the bulldozer on it, remember? And they just
they get
dug out a trench. It was probably 300 yards long. And all the fellows that didn't make it, this was cold. And the corpse would freeze. So they just left them out of there and laid them in the trenches, one after the other, and backfilled it and marked their graves. And then after the war, they moved them to two military cemeteries, one in St. Evold, and where's that other one?
There was St. Evold, or three others over there.
That's the only, it was very cold in the Battle of Hiroshima. One particular day we had snow as high as a Jeep hood. And it's hard to believe, but there are pictures in a couple of 12th Armored books of that happening. And boy, we didn't get, you never did get any snow packs, did you?
No, never.
I didn't get mine until end of April.
Mm-hmm.
But we just had regular leather combat boots.
You know, got them all, don't you?
Pardon? Well, the infantry, which is
the infantry didn't get them either. The guys in the Battle of Bulge never had them.
Well, no, but this was later.
They were all down in southern France and in England, and the quartermaster's office getting them. They were, everybody non-combatant were getting them.
The way I kept my feet warm, I'd pour gas on and light them. And then pretty soon you had the hot foot and you were jumping around in the snow, but I never got trench foot. And a lot of guys did. It's amazing. And it was tough keeping dry socks for them and other clothing.
Can you tell me about any experiences you had with the German
POWs? I didn't have any experience with them. I had about 11 surrendered to me, and another fellow and I. And another time down by Wauheim, one surrendered to myself and another guy. And then down by Innsbruck, it was 14 or 15 of them surrendered to us. We didn't know they were going to surrender for a while, but we were very fortunate because there were, each case, there was only two of us. And then I helped discharge the 19th German Army as the 12th Armored did. You didn't get in on that. But we had long lines of German soldiers. And as they came through, we sprayed them with DDT to degauss them. And they also had to strip to their waist and then help hold their arms over their head, and that way we were able to pick out the SS, and we held the SS, and then discharged the regular Wehrmacht.
How did you tell the difference there?
They had SS tattooed under their armpits. Some of them had tried to eradicate it by trying to scratch it out or whatever, but
did you find a distinct difference between the two groups?
Oh, yes.
The way they were?
The Wehrmacht were quite humane, really.
They were more like we were.
Yeah.
They didn't want to fight any more than we did.
But the SS were...
Domineering.
Domineering and very cruel, even to their own troops.
When did you first hear about the death camps?
Yeah, I did. The 12th Armored participated in Dachau and the one at Landsberg. And that started with H. I can't ever remember the name. But my unit tried to get to Landsberg. We left at 5 o'clock in the evening after crossing a river. And with a company of tanks and a company of or a platoon of recon, and I think there was, I'm not sure whether there was a company of infantry with us or not, but the idea was to get to Landsberg before they killed them or burnt them. They poured distillate over them and then lit it while they were alive. But we got cut off at 5 o'clock in the morning. We went all night. But the SS got us off 5 o'clock in the morning, and it took us till 11 o'clock to fight out of that pocket. And then we had to cross a river, and the only way to cross it was a railroad bridge which had one span blown. And always carried Decolo's bands, we always carried. Anyway, they got spans across there. And
the bridges?
Yeah. And as I went over, I thought, boy, this is, felt like it's about 200 feet high, but I guess it's probably 75 or so. You had to get on that thing, and tanks went across the two, and you had to look down, and all you had, there was nothing there. You couldn't see anything. But anyway, we got across that, and that slowed us down again. And we got into Landsberg about 5 o'clock. And the Germans had left, and a lot of the prisoners had come out into the town, and they had a stripe of It wore a striped uniform, but wasn't a uniform, it was just a cloth material, basically, and it was striped like you used to have for prisoners over here. And they were running around from house to house looting, trying to get clothes and something to eat. And, but the Landsberg concentration camp, we were able to save a lot of them, but they did stack a lot of them alive and put this one on and burn. The camp itself was older buildings, and all the sewage system were just ditches running through the yards. And it was a mess.
What was your duty or job during the occupation?
Occupation?
Mm-hmm.
When it came time to ship the 12th Army, they were going to ship them to the South Pacific, but the fellows were just short enough points to go back home. There was a point system in those days. They kept us for occupational duty. So I was a supply sergeant in the Combat Command A, the headquarters company, and so they transferred me to 1st Armored Division, the 4th Tank Battalion, the headquarters company, where I was also a supply sergeant. And there was a lot of turnover in those days, and the guys came up with them on points, they had to release them and send them home for discharge. And so I was promoted to 1st Sergeant of that company, and I served a couple of months, and when I got multiple sclerosis. Anyway, I was in the hospitals for some October through March of 45, and they didn't know what to do with me, and finally discharged me, and I went home and had all kinds of problems. Kept going to doctors, and some days were pretty good, some days weren't. But when I got multiple sclerosis, I lost my voice and used to this side. Anyway, we finally we started going to specialists in Denver. I was going to University of Wyoming, and I shouldn't have been doing that, I guess. I wasn't going to quit. And then we went to Lincoln, Nebraska to another specialist. And then we moved to Bozeman, Montana, and I found a doctor who had been in the Army, and he had also been a psychologist. And he's also a medical doctor. And so he started working with me and asked if I would take certain medicines. He said they may work and they may not, and I'll try anything. And I was getting along pretty good sometimes, and then the doctor and my wife worked it out. I didn't know this, but if I was getting out of hand and couldn't control myself, she would call up and say, it's time for him to give me some pills to knock me out and send me up to our cabin. I didn't know that until we moved to Helena from Bozeman. I went to this doctor, and he says, well, I went down there one day, he's having some problems, and he said, well, I guess it's time for me to give you some pills and send you back to the cabin. I said, what are you talking about? That's the first I found out about it. But anyway, I was determined not to be handicapped, and I just kept fighting it. And finally, in 51 and 52, I got so disgusted with myself, I couldn't see how anybody else could put up with me. I could work and do my job, but the time I got home, the stress and taking its toll. And so I went to an old family friend who was a psychiatrist and told him I couldn't live with myself. So he said, well, can I do all the tests to check and see if I know for myself whether it's multiple sclerosis? And anyway, he said yes, and said, there's nothing I can do for you, but you're going to have to do it for yourself, and that's just quit everything. So that's what I did, and I did still work, but I didn't, after I worked, I just sat around. So I did that about from 52 to the late 50s, and then they thought I had a brain tumor, and they did tests on that, and the x-ray showed all the lesions at the base of the brain from MS, and when they removed all the spinal fluid, and shot the dye in my veins to do x-rays of my head. But somehow or other, it took the pressure off from those lesions. And I got rid of the headaches, and I started getting better. And along with this other doctor, and taking shots every other day and doing a lot of other things, I started to come out of it. And then I went to state of remission, and my biggest problem today is getting a little bit irritated with the eye and fatigue. If I get too tired, I'm in trouble. And my wife kind of gauges that. Some days I thought it might have been better if I'd been wounded.
You know, John, I'll tell you, I'll be honest with you.
You never know.
I think I'd rather be in the condition I am than what you are with your position.
It's a toss-up.
Well, no, because I don't have those kind of problems. You know, I don't have to worry about what you have to go through. I don't go through that. My day is just like any other healthy person, and I just, do what I want to do. And when I don't want to do it, I don't do it, and I don't get an argument with nobody about it, and I don't, I'm fortunate that way. And I wouldn't trade you places for all the tea in China.
Well, and if I get under too much stress today, like I hit the Los Angeles freeways or something, and I'm a hillbilly from Montana, I mean, we don't have that kind of traffic, So there you are. Or even I-25 in Denver, that's a real bad one. But I build up stress, and I start losing my voice, can't talk. And as soon as I get off and rest in a couple of hours, I can talk again.
So you guys have not seen each other for how long?
50 years.
50. Well, it's 52 years.
Yeah.
How was last night?
Great. Yeah. Yeah, we were never really had too much to do with each other in the Army because we were both in different jobs, and I was on the road most of the time. And
we didn't see each other for days and days sometimes.
Yeah, and I wouldn't see him. And then when we did see each other, we always got along good.
Yeah.
And when the STP boys came to the 12th Armored Division, as we marched to our various places, the old tankers would give us the raw and all this. There's the whiz kids and all this stuff. And then they really didn't want to accept us too much, did they?
No, a lot of them didn't. If he, you know.
Orin wasn't that way. And I think the, what, we have six AST beer in headquarters company, wasn't it? About
yeah,
six.
Must have had that many, yeah.
And, but it was pretty tough on some of them, and the infantry companies and that, they really rode them hard. The first thing they did, I ended up in the 23rd tank at first. And they took us out of all the forward companies and headquarters and put us on a 20-mile march. And I happened to be lead man, and another kid from the STP, same school I was. And the idea was to show us that they wanted to show them how, or the 23rd wanted to show us how tough they were. So they had this officer that was going to just make a really rough 20-mile march. And we had full packs. And so I said to the other kid, I said, well, let's start off and let's keep stepping up the pace. And that's what we did. And that officer was back by the, when we got back, he'd been back by that truck. We was going to have to pick him up pretty soon. But we did that 20-mile march in record time. And then they left us alone.
Is there anything else?
Well, that's about it.
Yeah.